So, how to represent the early human experience of space? Well, I make a series of 10 remarks, and then we can draw some inferences, tentative inferences, and try to work from them. Any organism is in constant interaction with its proximal and distal environment. Surviving means the capacity to negotiate the spatial constraints within which it is embedded. It implies an adaptive competence to process relevant spatial information, including gravity. Hominins shared the legacy of the common ancestors of primates, which was adapted to arboreal life. Bipedalism afforded new means of interacting with the environment, but the conservation of adaptations to tree life was a mixed blessing, because while keeping one's balance and benefiting from rich chromatic visions remain an advantage, the lack of adequate evaluation of distance beyond a relatively close threshold was a limitation that deprived early humans from an adaptive perceptual and cognitive handling of perspective, a handicap that still puts us humans at a disadvantage compared to the descendant of the tetrapods that evolved as terrestrial quadrupeds and the bread. It's to realize that you have to remember when you are in a new city that you visit and you want to visit a tower. Ah, the tower you see, it is, you have no way, you think it is very close, but after 3 hours you are still walking toward, because our system is adapted to tree life, and in tree life you must be able to target, to reach a target or to grasp. And it cannot be there. But once you are on flat surface, you cannot say beyond a certain threshold what is before what. Yeah. And so that is an handicap, and we have always to try to negotiate these handicaps. Second remark. The geographical mobility of Homo erectus and its successors show that this spatial handicap was likely overcome through cultural means, such as the recording of memories in narratives or graphic representation that extended the representation of space beyond the immediate environment. And we know that in the archaeology record, we have things which very likely were actually maps. The human representation of space is indeed dependent on memory, since humans can only perceive the portion of space that lays in front of them until distance blurs the details or obstacles block the view. And of course, the primate cannot see behind, as the horses can see behind, but the primate cannot, they just see in front, and not as long as it should be adaptive. Contrary to the peripheral vision of the equids, for instance, humans need to change their position to scan the whole scope of the space in which they are immersed. The spatial cognition of contemporary humans has two main sources. On the one hand, the episodic memory of paths, vistas, and beacons, and on the other hand, the semantic memory of local and global maps and narratives. An important part of enculturation is the learning of the collective memory of spatial knowledge. We can reasonably assume that early humans possessed such spatial knowledge dependent on the culture in which they were born. However, it cannot be reasonably assumed that their perception, conceptualization, and representation of space was anything close to those of contemporary humans. Third remarks. Oh, okay, this is it. Now, obviously, we cannot use our current experience of space as a standard reference to understand the way in which early humans perceived, conceptualized, and represented their spatial environment. We belong to what historians have dubbed the culture of space and time that emerged during the last few centuries in Europe and spread to the whole globe. It is, however, easier said than to fully realize the implications of the differences when we try to understand the archaeological record from prehistoric and protohistoric times, and even to interpret pre-modern historic data. How to access such long past states of mind is a persistent challenge for archaeologists. Now, two heuristic paths are possible. First, we can attempt to imagine the experience of earlier humans by eliminating all the conceptual and technological tools that allow us to measure and represent space, both through our own experience of geographical mobility and the cognitive affordance of our collective memory made of the cumulative knowledge embodied in graphic representation and narrative. And secondly, we can examine the spatial experience of the few extant population of hunter-gatherers to which we have access. Both, so virtual subtraction, let us imagine how it is for someone who has not all what we have as a means of evading space. And secondly, let us see how, what is the experience of hunter-gatherers who have not been or limit, who have a limited exposure to contemporary culture. Both virtual subtraction and ethnographic investigation are risky methods, but they may complement each other in a productive way. So I put here the culture of time, the culture of time and space, which is a very interesting, very important book because it shows us, you know, how our current representation of space and time have been absolutely, you know, a fabrication of modern technology and also a demand of modern economic needs and so on. So, number four, another probably more reliable approach is to explore some inferences from comparison with other primate species. We can indeed assume with a high degree of certainty that early humans were both territorial and social. Territorial does not mean exclusively sedentary, but is compatible with some form of mobility within a range that is periodically covered and occasionally protected. Sociality, on the other hand, ensures that the memory of the spatial affordances of the range and the availability of food and other resources is distributed among the members of the group and is communicated both vertically and horizontally. The description of ape cultures are usually focused on the making of tools and the observation of particular social behavior, but the knowledge of the physical surrounding and its relevant characteristics is necessarily a crucial part of the shared knowledge of the group that is acquired during the development and reinforced through common experience. Bands of chimpanzees know where and when various kinds of trees come from fruition within their range. Patrolling and fighting intruders suppose some familiarity with the paths, beacons, and borders of a particular territory. There are, however, necessary limits to the spatial cognition beyond the range, although this expanse of space is within visual and acoustic reach. Yes, that was the book on the Hasda, which is a very interesting to see, you know, to try to imagine what was, you know, the life of hunter-gatherers. And that's comparative comparison with primate ethology. There are very interesting article for which I give the reference, territoriality, patrolling, paths and beacons, location and seasonal resources. There are, however, necessary limits to the spatial cognition beyond the range, although this expanse of space is within visual and acoustic reach. The interface between territories is a place of confrontation that defines the relative safety of home space as opposed to a hostile periphery. Penetrating that other space is rife with dangers, but it also provides opportunities for expanding the group's range and adding this spatial knowledge to its cultural capital. Point number five. An important aspect of the relation of space, of the relation to space, is to cognitively process it through distance evaluation from both egocentric and allocentric point of view. Whether an object or agent is within my reach or whether I am within their reach is a matter of life and death. Equally relevant to survival is the spatial relationship of objects and agents in the allocentric space. The use of body parts and gestures as standards of metrics is undoubtedly very ancient in the earliest form of referential verbal communication. That is, at a stone, you know, at a stone distance, stone's throw distance, a few steps, you know, the numbers with the hands and so on and so on. Hands, arms, feet, steps, and the maximum reach of a thrown stone, for instance, provide units of spatial evaluation that enable the control of spatial information. However, contemporary humans have inherited from their tree-dwelling ancestors the limited capacity to evaluate relative distance, as I mentioned earlier. Point number six. So I'll give some references on distance perception. The psychologists have done a lot of work on this type of things. So the perceptual constraints necessarily impacted the relationship of early humans to the diurnal and nocturnal sky that must have appeared much closer to the ground than it does to us now. Modern humans' perception is biased by the knowledge of the inconceivable distances provided by the astronomical sciences. In the work of someone who has studied hunter-gatherers and their what they call astroarchaeology, I think Stephen Fabian, or maybe Hurton, refers that when he discusses with one of the indigenous people that a man had been landed on the moon, this person was not surprised because for him, moon was very close. And he said, yes, but it would be more difficult, it would be impossible to land on the sun. But the sun conceived as an object, you know. So the moon, the fact that you look at the moon, you have to know that it is, how far it is, because, and so it was not surprised. It was surprising to this man that someone had landed on the moon. It was difficult, of course, but not surprising. So I put here the book, you know, that's quite interesting by Stephen Fabian, and the one by Gary Hurton, which has, and also we have all the work of Ezra Zubrow on the same topic. Now, another important difference in the experience of space between early and contemporary humans is a scientific distinction between animate and inanimate. Modern science has taught us that mindless physical forces such as gravity or magnetism explain the movement of objects according to the physical laws of nature. Biological dynamics is spontaneously interpreted as being goal-directed with various degrees of conscious motivation and planning. In interspecific interactions, the fight or flee reflex determines behavior, but experimental evidence shows that humans and higher primates have evolved a capacity to represent others' intention when they assess the probability of their next move. This competency has been dubbed the theory of mind, which is not an explanation of what mind is, but the fact that we have the capacity of knowing that someone else has a mind like ours, and therefore we can assume that it functions about the same way. And that has been absorbed. So this competency has been dubbed the theory of mind, meaning that the egocentric point of view is complemented by an ability to make allocentric hypotheses regarding the state of mind of others. In other words, to assume that they possess a mind which enables them to similarly evaluate situations and act according to their understanding of this situation. And naturally, that's what we can devise strategies in function of what we think someone else believes. Organisms endowed with this evolved capacity have a marked advantage since they can anticipate the probable strategies they will have to counter in the competitive games of life and death. However, the theory of mind can become a liability if it is generalized to all sources of dynamism, whether biological or not. volcanic eruptions, earthquakes, landslides, storms, eclipses, and other meteorological phenomena can be interpreted as intentional and call for counter-strategies such as sacrifices of other rituals designed to placate their anger. And I have showing something recently. It has been discovered in the north of Chile that 250 children were sacrificed as a way of placating meteorological disturbances which were caused by El Nino in the year, I think it was in the 15th century or something like that. I don't have the exact that, but so at least not so long ago, I read in the news that in Indonesia, people have thrown a cow in a volcano in order to placate the volcano and keep it from that. Few days ago, I read in the news that in Florida, a group of evangelicals gathered close to the shore and prayed the storm not to come to Florida and to go away to, of course, Virginia or Carolina. So not, and of course, you have no way, when people believe that, you have no way of demonstrating that they are wrong. Absolutely no way. So this thing is still with us. This type of knowledge is still with us. For the modern mind, point eight. From the modern mind, space is an affordance we take for granted, like the air we breathe. We have indeed eliminated the other species which, until relatively recently, were able to enforce their own claim to ownership of space. For early humans, space was necessarily a shared community. Human ranges were overlapping with the ranges of many other species, which could stand their ground as well as, if not better, than they could do themselves. It is conceivable that early tribes could come with some form of territorial agreement, willingly or not, with other tribes. But predators and other territorial animal species were not amenable to such primal civility. The relationship to a vital space that is forcefully conquered, temporarily borrowed, or opportunistically stolen, implies a sense of occupancy markedly different from our regulated use of surveyed and groomed space. In Switzerland is a good example of surveyed and groomed space to an extreme. Our civilized institutions and technologies have indeed domesticated space to the extent that wilderness is preserved only as a touristic attraction or a rhetorical trope, with the exception of some rare, truly wild areas that cannot be easily accessed, explored, and exploited. Now, I come to my final point. I still have 5 minutes. The fact that early humans could have only a direct knowledge of their immediate spatial range and the memory of their experience of past exploratory forays beyond their usual horizon did not preclude them from having a sense of a wider space within their own niche. It can be assumed, indeed, that at least two sources of information were available to them. First, the cumulative memories of past generations conveyed through narratives. Also, as we know, in an oral culture, the memory does not go beyond 2 or 3 generations. You can, you know, there is no preservation of information over. Maybe I am wrong, but I deal from my own ethnographic research with circus people and circus family who are illiterate, and that it's impossible. They don't remember. They don't know anything beyond the 3rd generation in the back, unless they have some ways of recording, you know, like the Brahmins in India, where the first thing the boys do is to learn, you know, 200 names of their ancestors. More decisive, too, was the vantage point of hilltops and cliffs that could reveal vast expanses of land. However, such sources of spatial information carry their own limitation for at least 3 reasons. Surveying could be done only by walking in a landscape that was mostly opaque and hostile, and cumulative knowledge was necessarily constrained by the early humans' short span of life. Moreover, we know that in oral culture, the maintenance of collective memory is limited. At least that is what I think, but it may be wrong. So I have some references here concerning the theory of mind. The first book, the first text, was an article by Primack, Woodruff, several people, published in Learning Theory. And there is also the one from by Primack and Woodruff, Does the Chimpanzee Have a Theory of Mind? And this is the first time that the expression, I believe, has been used in that sense. So that was a list of the shared what I was mentioned earlier. Now, I am coming to the end. History and prehistory are deeply concerned with human mobility, and routes are traced on modern maps, assigning plausible points of origin and approximate times of arrival based on the dating of the archaeological record. With our own ingrained modern perspective of space, enhanced by 21st century achievement in astronomy and geography, we trace the routes of migration over tens of millennia with reference to Western virtual constructions of the various parts of the globe that was colonized quite recently by Europeans. There cannot be any doubt that, like many of our contemporaries, early humans assumed that the Earth was broadly flat in spite of the peaks and trough of which they had direct experience. Prehistoric migration must have been slow, half-blind process, during which there was no sense of drastic change in the environment, except, of course, when waterways or maritime transportation were involved. Furthermore, it is plausible that mobility was caused by needs rather than wanderlust, because resources were getting scarce or hostile newcomers arrived, shown that our cognition generally biased our perception. Now, something which is very important, and I finish with that, is that there is strong evidence that early humans paid intense attention to the nocturnal sky and carefully represented that diversely patterned space in their rock art. Paleoastronomy is a relatively recent discipline that casts an interesting light upon the complex combination of zoomorphic and geometric design that can be identified on the wall of caves. So, space and memory, zoomorphism, we have to also assume that there was a lot of invisible, they believe in a lot of invisible in their space. Even now, I remember in Indonesia doing some research there, and I was driven with an assistant, an informant, and at some point the car slowed down very, very, very slow, say, like walking, and I say, what's happening? He said, oh, there are spirits there, and if you drive too fast, you have an accident. Recently in Iceland, they voted against building a highway somewhere because that would disturb the elves. So we can assume that the prehistoric mind had also. After all, they were burying their dead. And now if you bury the dead with some goods and ornaments, you have to put the dead somewhere. So it is very likely that there were places which were hotspots, like taboos. And so there was a part of the invisible in their own space. So I will stop here because I have reached the point, and you have the concluding, in the booklet. Okay, so tentative conclusion. Early human experience, space in a markedly different, fuzzier border, etc. It's just what we have said so far. I don't want to go further than that. And so it is just, a sort of warmed up, to what we follow, which again will be the art, the real stuff. Thank you.